Afternoon and welcome on this afternoon's sunset safari. For those of you who are joining us for the first time, I'm actually going to stop the car because if I try and do this and track at the same time, we're going to miss something. My name is Jamie and this afternoon I have Gert, also known as Carrot, on camera with me. I'm not sure how he feels about that nickname, but he's shaking his head at me. But nevertheless, that is the way things seem to be going. We are coming to you live from Juma, Arethusa and Cheetah Plains Game Reserves in the Sabi Sand in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. Not only are we live, but we're also interactive, which means you can send through your questions on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. Brent is also out and about with Jandre. I don't actually know what his plans are. He's gone off somewhere that way, the sort of easterly direction. I'm in the western corner of Juma, the southwestern corner to be exact. And the reason I am concentrating so hard right now is we had a really exciting moment at the end of the sunrise safari this morning. Now, Herbert was hard at work helping us track down things this morning. He drove along this road, he came back 15 minutes later, and there were fresh leopard tracks. He thinks of Shadow and her cub. So Shadow, the daughter of the famous Queen Karula of Juma, who shares her boundary with her mum and who has a four-month-old leopard cub with her. Now, we're concentrating really hard this afternoon. First of all, we're going to make sure that she hasn't come out of this area. And once we've done that, then I think I'm going to go for a little stroll into one of Shadow's favorite spots and see if she doesn't have a kill hidden somewhere in here. So bear with me while I keep glancing off to the side. This is a main road. She has picked sort of a spot where lots and lots of things happen. Lots of vehicles come past, so I need to concentrate nice and carefully on making sure that she hasn't popped out. But luckily for me and for you, it seems as though Brent has gone off to a very special spot. Let's go across and see what marvelous surprise he has for you.
Welcome to the Sunset Safari, and we are at the Inkahuma Den, and Mom is here. Isn't that great news? We can't see any of the cubs, we just see a very relaxed looking Mom at the moment. Oh, rolling over. Watch out you don't squash your babies. Now, we're going to be playing the patience game this Sunset Safari, and I think as it gets cooler, there's a good chance she might play with the cubs or they might move out into the open. And now because Mom's here, we're able to stay. Oh, back to sleep, Mom. I wonder if she dislodged any cubs in that movement. Not that we can see, but I'm sure they're around there somewhere. Probably snuggled very close to her. And I am, of course, Brent. And I have Jandre on camera. And we are very excited to bring you Saturday Cat Day Cub Day, hopefully. We're going to sit here and play the patience game with the little ones. And hopefully Jamie is able to find Shadow and her little one. Now, I'm surprised we haven't seen a little flicker of movement from one of the cubs. Now that Mom's rolled over, they might squirm out to try and get a drink. Now, if you or I had to lie in that particular thicket, we would be completely ripped apart by that fallen knob thorns. That shows you how tough these creatures are, able to withstand all those thorns and actually look quite comfortable while doing it. And you see the little flicking of Mom's ear. Still no sign of the little ones. I'm very confident they're there. Probably just hidden behind her body at the moment. I think the first sight we're going to see of them is going to be around the center of her body there, as they might wake up and get a bit thirsty and head, there we go, for that area Jandre's zooming in on. Oh, we can see all the flies on her. Most of those are probably going to be stable flies, those very irritating little biting flies that cover a lot of our wildlife here in the Sabi Sands Game Reserve. And we're at the moment on the northeastern corner of Juma. And remember, this is a live African safari. And also, you can ask me any questions you'd like by using the email address questions@wildearth.tv. Oh, she's getting irritated with the flies. That's a flick of that tail. Or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Now, as those cubs grow, that tail is going to become quite an important thing. And it is one of a lion cub's favorite toys. It's always moving slightly, so a great thing to practice pouncing upon and biting. Oh, I think that's fly. I'm just trying to scan very carefully. See if I can pick up any movements of the cubs. Now, this is the first time that I've been here, and I think also Jean-Marie's been here, that Mom's actually been here. Normally, we just stay a couple of seconds, and then we move out. But now, with Mom's here, we're going to have the opportunity... Sorry, the sun is right in my eyes. It's right behind us here. We're going to have the opportunity to spend a bit longer here and hopefully get some incredible shots of those gorgeous little Inkahuma babies. Sorry, I can't stare at the sun too much longer without going blind. Jandre, of course, is going to keep the camera on me. He thinks he's very funny. Look at the lion, Jandre. Well, I'm looking at my monitor now, Jandre, so yeah. Now, it is still quite warm, and on this beautiful winter's evening, and I think as it gets cooler, Mom might move out into the open, and I'm hoping she brings the cubs with her onto the open of the termite mound. And hopefully we'll get a sight of them playing. Is that a cub there, Jandre? Is that a paw? So we're just trying to spot, looks like a paw. Every now and then, I think I hear a little ow. Red Dog is wondering, do lions ever roll in mud for fly protection? Jandre is trying to make me stare at the sun again. I'm going to stare to see if I can see the little cubs. No, they don't. Generally, they'll rely on those twitches in the skin, those sort of nervous reactions. Nerve reactions. That send a little shimmer, almost like a twitch through the skin to try to dislodge flies. They also flick their ears, swing their tails. And in certain areas, when the flies get really, really bad, they'll often climb up into a tree. And so lions can climb trees. They're just not as good at it as leopards are. And where there's a slight more of a breeze to protect them from the flies. So she'll be lying very close. As I said to those little ones, I'm sure that just our view of them is being stopped by her body. So I heard right at the end of the sunrise safari that she had come back and someone had spotted her walking back in this direction. So this was always where I was going to head today. And I'm hoping to get some wonderful views of those little cubs with the mom. Now, she probably gave birth in this area. And when those cubs are as small as they are, she's probably not going to move them unless there's some outside circumstances that might cause her to move them. Movement of male lions or hyenas close by. And that she'll probably leave them sometimes for up to 3 weeks in the initial den before moving them to another den. Generally, the den won't be too far. And she's quite lucky. There's a myriad of these little dongas, as we call them in South Africa. Now, a donga is a sort of a like a little dry creek or erosion gully. But they are natural. And this is one here that we're on. And you can see water would flow right down in the bottom of that. Now, this actually flows all the way to Buffalo's Hook Dam. So I just need to be on the radio for a second. Afternoon, there's a large slumber of Ndlov around or heading north from Vuyotela. And one station with one Satyangala at the den site off Buffalo's Hook cut line. 1 out of 5 visual and no visual of the cubs. Come on, Mom, move so we can see the babies. Now, as Jean-Ré scans, just look carefully. You might pick up a little bit of movement that we haven't seen before. And it's Mom's ear. Maybe beyond Mom or in the foreground to Mom. Apart from the occasional flick of a tail and movement from the biting flies, Mom looks quite relaxed. Now, while we wait, we could always do a tree quiz, since we're sitting next to so many trees. Jean-Ré, which tree should we do?
The dead one.
Don't think it's a bit easy. I think I've mentioned what the dead one is too many times since we've been here. Let's do this. These little two right off in front of me here. So there we go. Very round shaped leaves. And have a look. There's some thorns. But if we look at the bark a little bit lower down, it does look quite flaky. And there's some very distinct protrusions from it. So if you think you know what little tree this is, let me know by sending me an email to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Mom is not moving a muscle at the moment, and neither are we. Now, Liz would like to know is if this is the litter that James found. I think, yes, he was. He was the first of us to see it. Yes, Jean-Ré is nodding his head to me. So these are the youngest we know about, but there are 3 Nkuma lionesses that are currently lactating. So we've only found 2 of the litters, so there could still be, well, there is still a third. We're not sure how many or where she's denning at the moment. So it could be very exciting that we're going to have 3 different sets of Nkuma cubs. So this is indeed the one that James found. The other group of lion cubs is currently in Buffalo's Hook from the last tracks I saw of them. Was crossing into our boundary, probably about 3 km from here. So they are unfortunately not currently on Juma at the moment. But I think these guys have been born on Juma and are going to be on Juma for the next little while before they're about 2 months old when they start moving around with the pride. So I would guess these guys to be 2 to 3 weeks old at the maximum. So we've had one guess for our tree quiz, and it is not a silver cluster leaf. A silver cluster leaf doesn't have thorns. So let's have a quick look at it again for me there, please, Jean-André. Let's focus down on the bark a little bit lower. Okay, so we can see there, silver cluster leaf has got very distinct bark. I'm trying to see one, but I can't see one near us at the moment. But if we look more carefully on the little branchlets, there are hooked thorns on that. So it is not a silver cluster leaf. And also the shape of the leaves, very round, and they're bipinnate leaves. So Dean's wondering if I've got to be ready for a quick getaway in case that female, that lioness starts getting aggressive, or is her body language enough to let us know that she's relaxed? Well, her body language will let us know, and with most of the animals, we're reading their body language, and I can see from her body language at the moment that she couldn't give two hoots about us being here. I mean, when we first arrived, she didn't even lift her head. She knows we're here. She can hear me speaking. She heard the car coming. And she's just snoozing. Cat's wondering at what age will she introduce them to the rest of the pride. Now, cat's normally at about 2 weeks old, 2 months old at the earliest, sometimes a little bit later, sometimes a little bit earlier, but normally around that 8 week mark is when they first get introduced to the pride. Doesn't mean they stay with the pride, but they will be taken to kills if the pride makes a big enough kill. Now, I'm hoping that someone is figured out what the tree is. I'm just going to try and move the vehicle slightly. I don't think so. I think this is the best spot we've got, unfortunately, for now. And we will have to wait. And we are going to have to play the patience game to see what happens here. Now, well done to a curious one who has got the answer spot on for the tree quiz. These are two very young knob thorns, or Acacia nigrescens. Now, it seems like Jamie has been walking after leopards, and she's back on the car, so let's go see if she's had any success.
I have indeed been walking after leopards, and unfortunately, the only thing I found was one very startled steenbok, and a couple of very unhappy waxbills, blue waxbills to be precise, a little fluttering birds that kept me company whilst I went searching for Shadow. I'm afraid no good news to tell you just yet, but the afternoon is yet young and we're still making sure that we scour the area to make sure that she hasn't popped out. The biggest difficulty in this particular patch is that it's an absolutely enormous section of bush. I say enormous as if, you know, it's incomparable. It's not 100% true, but for our region, it's one of the biggest areas without roads, which means she could be hiding absolutely anywhere, somewhere in this block, and in the Strychnos thickets, or in the Tambuerti thicket that I went for a walk in. It is very difficult, very tricky to see if there's any sign of her there. But we're going to keep looking, and hopefully as the afternoon draws on and people start to go out in their vehicles, we'll have a little bit of help to circle this region. But what I did was I went and I walked around, basically almost aimlessly, because there's patches of that ground where it's next to impossible to see a track. It is very, very rocky. So I kind of just, hello, walked. Hello, boy. You've gone very still. What you thinking? Did you get a surprise? I got a surprise too. Hello, big boy. Oh, what a nice way to start off our afternoon. We might not have a leopard, but we do have an elephant bull that is doing marvelous work in clearing away strychnos, or monkey orange, from this area. My other suspicion is, while I was walking around in there, just speaking about elephants, I think that there is a very good chance that at some point a shadow was chased by an elephant herd. There are fresh tracks all the way through, over parts where I could see her tracks. I think that perhaps she has been chased a little bit further into the block. Hey, boy. You've made life very difficult. Totally hidden away. I think he's going to move out into the open for us, so we'll be able to have a slightly better look. So a youngish male, just judging by his size, I would say maybe about 5 or so years spent living away from the safety of his herd and all on his own. So at this point he's relatively comfortable with his own size. And quite content to accept a life of solitude for now. Little big boy, there have been so many elephants around. It's been an absolute pleasure. Oh boy, he's definitely playing camera shy. Let's go forward a little bit, see if we can't get a slightly clearer view of our lovely elephant bull, and then perhaps he will decide to walk out a bit more into the open. Hello, boy. No, still playing camera shy. What he's doing at the moment, when I said that he is munching away on monkey orange, he is performing a very valuable conservation function, because monkey orange is an encroacher species, which means that it grows in thick clumps almost to the exclusion of a great number of other species, including the grass species. By the elephant moving through and clearing them away, he's doing a marvelous job of helping out the area, helping to keep the area clear of its woodland layer. Come on, boy. Oh, I think he really is a little bit shy. I don't think that he wants to be on camera. Perhaps he'll walk out in front of us on the road. No, we're playing hide and seek now. It's definitely where he wants to be, is in the thickest patch of bush and as far away from us as possible. Oh, there we go. Come on, boy. You look a little bit lost. Are you looking for some company, maybe? There's something wonderful about watching an elephant move. There's that slight tilt of the head in our direction. It doesn't necessarily mean he's angry. It's just like a natural curiosity to turn and watch us. Now, the interesting thing about that is the great trackers that I have encountered before in my life, they can look at an elephant track and say that elephant stopped and turned, didn't move necessarily, didn't take another step, just turned ever so slightly, swung his head, and that creates just the tiniest of shifts in an elephant track in the sand. That's not something I even begin to claim to be able to do. I don't have that level of expertise, but it is something wonderful about the way in which our master trackers of the area work. Oh, I know where he was going. There's actually another elephant in there. It's really hard to see. Behind him, I just saw a cloud of dust go billowing up into the air. It's also what made my life difficult in terms of tracking shadow, is that there just appear to be elephants everywhere here. Everywhere I walked, I could hear branches cracking. And on a windy day like today, it is starting to get a bit windy. It's best to be as cautious as possible in avoiding the elephants. That's why he looked so lost. He was on his way to go and join a friend. I'm not sure if you saw that dust cloud, but there was one. Promise. There's definitely another elephant in there. All right, let's go check a bit further north, make sure Shadow hasn't crossed up there. So she shares this boundary. We're on the boundary between Juma and Arethusa. And she shares this boundary with her mother. Now we spoke, well actually Brent spoke about this 2 days ago when he saw Saleeshe right in the middle of Shadow's territory. Saleeshe is another female leopard coming in from the western edge of Shadow's territory. And we think she's pushing Shadow, and Shadow in turn is going to push more and more into her mother's territory. Because whilst female leopards are territorial, even when they're related, even if it's a mother or a mother and a daughter, it's still kind of the lesser of two evils for Shadow to move away from a large unrelated female and towards the territory of her mother. And there's a whole section here that's kind of not quite a no man's land, but it's that exact boundary that Karula and Shadow share. And that is where we are checking now. As I said, the biggest problem here is that this is the main access road from the gate that leads into the reserve. So anything from trucks to lorries to guest vehicles, whoever might be coming through here, they all drive along. And as a result, it becomes very tricky to see whether or not there's any tracks coming out. I think what we should do, actually, is we're going to just quickly pop over to Red Dam in case we have missed her tracks. We'll pop over to Red Dam, see if there's a chance that she's drinking around there. While we do, let's head across to Brent for an update.
I can't listen to it. So there we go, and Jandre is doing a focus pull from the Buffalo Thorn. Sorry, I had Final Control and Game Drive talking to me and Jandre talking to me at the same time, so I'm going to try to figure out one at a time. Jamie's still following up on it now. It went into the block to the west of Zoe's. Their general direction was sort of almost due west into that block, but no sign of them crossing Triple M. Okay, sorry. Yes, Jandre, that it was a Buffalo Thorn, and that's what Jandre was asking me. And then I don't even know what Final Control was saying, but literally at the exact same time, I had three people talking to me. And I consider myself multi-talented, but that was just too much. So I've actually spotted where the cubs are, and I just saw a bit of movement. So I'm going to use my hand to show you, because it's not very easy. Okay, there's she. The cubs are literally there where my fingertip is, in that mess of thicket there. And the only reason, there we go, Jandre spotted the movement. Now, that is a lion cub, believe it or not. So, here we go. And every now and then I'm hearing them go, ow, ow. That means they are going to start getting hungry and start crawling towards mom. Now, which part of a lion cub that is, I could not tell you. Jandre, any guesses? Belly, maybe? No. So that's where the three little snuggle monsters are snuggled together. They're probably less than half a meter from Mom, who's lying just on the edge. Now, even Mom would have a hard time getting into that thicket there, and that's why it's such a good den site for her. That very, very little is going to be able to get in there and get to those cubs. As I said, hoping she's going to call them out. Before she heads off hunting again. Hi, Mitch. Mitch is in New York. He's wondering why aren't the furry animals here... Oh, sorry. This is very, very noisy on the Game Drive radio today. I'm turning it off. There we go. Done. Mitch, you have my undivided attention. So, Mitch is wondering why the furry animals here aren't completely inundated with fleas. Mitch, they are. But they're just used to it. And especially the denning animals like hyenas, wild dogs, even warthog, they will get complete infestations of fleas. And that causes them to use different hideouts. Or different den sites from time to time. That's why hyenas are constantly on the move, is because of fleas. Most of the animals here that have got fur, and predators in particular, will have fleas. And it's just one of those things about being out in the bush, and they don't have anyone to put a flea collar on them. Although I think Jandre might want to try with this lioness, Jandre? No? Okay, Jandre doesn't want to try put a flea collar. I certainly don't. So I think we'll leave it at that. They do have fleas, but unfortunately for them, there's very little they can do about it, apart from scratch the itch. Now, Jonathan's saying, often hear about animals dying because predators catch them, but are there any diseases that might kill animals earlier? There's a whole host of diseases, but even then, the predators will eat those animals once they're dead. That's how things work out here. And you'll find a lot of the predators are immune to lots of nasty things that would probably be quite bad if you were an impala. Because they're able to eat carrion, rotting meat, botulism, all that type of stuff, they're actually quite immune to. And as soon as an animal starts getting affected by a disease, it becomes slower and weaker, and that's when the predators pick them off. So it's a bit of a combo in that case, that they don't really manage to get away too easily. Even if they are feeling a bit under the weather from a disease, the lion or the leopard or the hyena or wild dog, cheetah, will take advantage of that. Come on, little guys, get hungry. Now, lions are very interesting because they're quite unique in the big cat family. They are the only social predator, or only social big cat. Now, Brock is wondering whether they are the only of the cats that are social. And Brock, there are no other truly social cats throughout the world. And it's probably because of their evolution and where they've evolved in a very highly competitive area, the African savannah, where there were other social predators like human beings and hyenas to compete with. And it's a very, very interesting thing if you look back at the history of lions and the way lions react to people and to hyenas and different other predators in their ecosystem. During the day, lions will run off from a human being 99% of the time. We're the dominant diurnal predator. And a group of men is quite capable, even with spears, of killing a lion. And vice versa, a single lion, a group of lions, much easier to catch, very easily can catch a single person as opposed to a group of people. But during the day, during night, that changes. Day is our time. Nighttime is the time of the lions. So as soon as it becomes dark, we become part of their prey. So they move, and we try and move indoors into caves to get protection, where there's the lions rule the night. Oh, look there on the... Oh, it flew off. It's flying towards Zion. It was a Chandra's favourite, a butterfly, but it escaped. It looked like a little Xeraxes, but I landed on the bonnet and then took off towards the lioness. Still no movement from those cubs. So we were following a lioness. I think it was actually this lioness across quarantine last week. And she happened to spy one of the guys who's building our new final control. And he was wandering around where he shouldn't have been at that time of the day. And she immediately changed and went into stalk mode. And Angie is wondering about the rest of the story and what happened when it was off air. Not much. I think pretty much basically what happened while I was on air, I drove and put myself, the vehicle, between the lioness and the person. And then I shouted at her and went, hey! And I tapped the side of the car a bit. Bang, 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 bang. Just break her concentration. And then just kept my vehicle between her and the person till the person had got around the corner and into the staff village. Then left her, shouted at the person, and then went back and followed her to have a drink. And so, fortunately, the story could have gone a little bit worse, but she was quite full. If she'd been really hungry, it might have been a little bit more difficult to dissuade her from stalking that person. What have you seen, John Ray? Nothing.
An ear twitch.
Yes. Now, for those of you who watch lots of nature documentaries, now, and there's wonderful cut together shots of cubs and playing and whatnot. This is how you get them. By sitting and waiting patiently next to a lion or leopard den. Sometimes you get lucky and the playing starts within 2 minutes of you arriving. 90% of the time it's like this, playing the patience game. I think what we might do is go for a little amble to the Buffalo's Hook waterhole and then come back in 5 or 10 minutes. And maybe something will have changed then. But I don't see it moving in the next 30 seconds. So. But there's always a very strong chance that we will not get to see them playing in this evening, because when it gets a little bit later, we immediately zone this area. There's no after dark activities or spotlights or lights. Even before the sun goes completely down, we'll zone this area. Now, you can see there's a bit of work happening at Gari Dam, where the Juma Pan Cam is, and Johanna's wondering what's going on there. They are deepening and bolstering the wall in case of La Nina at the end of this year, and they're also bolstering the wall of the little Juma Pan. The elephants and buffalo keep breaking it down, and the water, the precious water, keeps disappearing. This is the area where we had a very brief sighting of a honey badger this morning scuttling along. So who knows, maybe they'll be out and about again this evening. Going to have to go under the leaning it's probably just her, the lion tracks on the road here. They weren't here this morning. Ah, yeah, see, there they were, straight in towards the den. Here we have the leaning terminalia of Biffle's Hook East. I just have to slow down so Jandre can lower the antenna. We're good? There we go. Okay, so we're going to keep checking. While we do that, let's go across and see how Jamie's tracking is going.
While Brent heads and checks out Biffle's Hook Dam area, the trail for Shadow is hotting up, and something scared a group of kudu in this block where her tracks lead into. They were giving off those deep booming bah sounds that are so typical of kudu alarm call. The difficulty is I don't know whether she's moving this way or that way. I'm desperately trying to split myself in two to try and work out where she's going to go. Our biggest risk is that she's going to cross Triple M without us finding her, because that's where those tracks will disappear. Now let us go and double check she's not on her way here. And then unfortunately at some point we are going to have to return to camp, because poor Gert's earpiece has stopped working completely. So he has no idea when we're live and when we're not, and I actually forgot to tell him that we were about to go live. Alright everybody, eyes peeled. Kudu tend to be very, very reliable in terms of their alarm calls. They are so good at spotting things. They very seldom give a false alarm. And the reason that their bark is so deep is because a deep sound travels further through the bush. So long sound waves essentially travel further than short sound waves. Now that deep barking sound, the loudest alarm call, the loudest vocalization of any antelope that we get out here. And they were trying to tell us that there's a leopard somewhere here. I think. Might have been a lion. You never know. Generally, a kudu don't alarm call for anything else, really, unless it's a cheetah, which is possible but quite unlikely. Shadow? We know you're here somewhere. They were just a little bit in here, looking. I couldn't actually see them properly. And hello to Iodine in Illinois. Iodine wants to know what would happen to Shadow and her cub if they encountered Karula. What would Karula do? Oh goodness, here comes the dust cloud. Oh well, gives us an opportunity to sit and wait and see if Shadow's coming this way. So Iodine, it's a weird thing. It's very unpredictable with leopard behavior, particularly mother and daughter. So there have been recorded cases of mother and daughter sharing a kill, and there's even been a very unusual case. Winter is dusty. Very, very unusual case where a grandmother ended up sharing a kill with her daughter and her daughter's cubs and adopting her daughter's cubs. Now that's a very, very unusual situation. Nobody really knows why that would occur. That being said, we don't know really what would happen. They'd probably, most likely, there'd be a bit of growling, a bit of posturing, the little cub would run away, and they would probably have moved apart into different directions. I'm just listening. I'm sure she's here. This is so frustrating. I'm sure she is somewhere in this region. Kudu don't alarm call for nothing. Okay, no sign of her here. Perhaps let us go and check further to the north. We've checked west. She's probably moving, given that the kudu were alarm calling, or it's just started alarm calling. So let's go and try and check elsewhere. I'm desperately attempting to recruit people to help me search, but everybody's on opposite ends of the reserve. This is very sad. Ooh. try not to throw poor cat off the other end. Okay. And I'm sure she's being pushed by the elephants. That's why she's moving. Okay, one last solid good check behind me. And that she's not coming through here. And then let us go a little bit further in. Oh, when one hears alarm calls like that, it gets very frustrating when you don't know exactly what it is they're alarm calling at. Let us go and see. I'm sure it's her. Now, unfortunately, poor Gert is going to have to live without radio comms for now. His poor, defeated earpiece dangling from my fingertips. Because if we leave now, we might miss an opportunity of finding her, which I don't want to risk. So poor Gert's just going to have to do it. You think you can manage, Gert?
I will.
Okay. He says he'll manage. Balanites tree. Or the Gowrie repeater. Let's go check the Gowrie repeater. Eugene would be proud. Okay, everybody, keep your eyes peeled. The interesting thing is that there's a herd of impala just here, and they have not alarm called at all. Well, there was an impala alarm call. Try that again. There was an impala herd somewhere here, and they've been completely silent. It's the kudu that have been unhappy. The impala are looking at us. They're not looking at a leopard. So she must, the kudu alarm calls came from further in, which means that, which does mean that she must be further into the block. Hello, Impalala. Have you seen a leopard by any chance? They look okay, a bit bunched together. They're not feeding. But that might just be because that ram has caused them a little bit of concern. No. They seem fine. They're not even staring off into the same direction. Okay, let's go check Gowrie repeater. Hey, everybody, keep your eyes peeled. Chelsea, are you looking hard? I've got Chelsea on the back, by the way. And she's going to help us keep track. And while I look for footprints crossing this road, don't think she would have crossed yet, though. Oh, this is such a tricky spot, and it's one of Shadow's all-time favorites to disappear off in here. Is there a chance that the kudu were alarm calling at the impala, perhaps? I don't think so. As I said, they're usually quite reliable, but you never know. They might be getting confused. I'm going to keep checking, make sure that she hasn't popped out here, and while we do, and then decide what to do about poor Gert's earpiece, let's go across to Brent, who has made it to Biffleshoek Dam.
So you can see how the drought is taking grip of the Biffleshoek waterhole, and it's mostly mud now, and unfortunately for Bachelor Bob, it's the only water he can access. So the other deeper water holes will be full of big, nasty male hippos that won't let him anywhere near the ladies. And of course, Bachelor Bob is not the only one who's going to suffer as this water dries up. Oh, what have you spotted? Oh, he's just got some mud on his top of his head. Nice reflection there as well. And if we come out onto the mud over there, there's another critter that's going to be looking for a new home in a couple of weeks. It's a little hinge-backed terrapin who's basking in the sun at the moment. But they are going to have to move from what water that is left here. Now, they all walk happily all the way to sort of the Juma pan. And I think it might find that pan quite full of other terrapins as well. And flying around, there we go. Ooh, nice, Jandre. There's a blacksmith lapwing. We heard that tink, tink. There it is. That's where it gets its name from. Sounds like a blacksmith hammering steel on his anvil. And we'll also have to find another spot that's got some water for them to hang around. Fortunately, they're not as dependent on the water as some of the other species that are here at the Buffleshook Waterhole at the moment. And some other birds also utilizing at the moment, who are also going to have to move. Now, our dry seasons out here are always dry. And Eric in Rio is wondering, is this a normal dry season or not? No, Eric, this is much drier than it normally would be at this time of the year. And there's barely a blade of grass. And there's been almost no rain throughout the rainy season. So that's... What have you spotted, Jandre?
No grass.
Oh, no grass. Jandre is showing you that there's no grass. But speaking of birds, it sounds like there's a really nice little... bird party behind us. I'm just going to try and move. I can hear at least four or five different species, and I'm really hoping one of them could be a new one for our birders out there. So we're going to fall off the back of the damn wall. Whoa! Maybe not literally go that far. So nice thing is, yeah, we're almost in the canopy. So let me see if we can spot them. I heard them behind me. Okay, I'm just trying to spot them. I can hear them. I think let's have a look a bit further forward. Might be a little bit deep into this little river system. Now we can see it quite clearly now. So this is now further down from where that lioness is, and you can see it's become a bit bigger. There's that lovely river sand at the bottom. And that little bird party sounds like it's a little bit too far down this little river system. Okay. I'm going to wander on a little bit more. Before making our way back to the lioness. Is out and about in the northeastern corner of Juma. Now, the wonderful thing about being out in a live safari is we literally cannot plan what is around the next corner. And around the next corner shall be Jandre. You smelt a lion poo. No, there's quite a lot of it around here, Jandre. Okay. Alright, what is around the next corner? Here's your corner, Jandre. Here's your opportunity. Here's your moment to shine. Elephant done. Yes, no, there's a lot of that as well. Okay, so we're going to stop asking Jandre. Well, I was hoping we might find some of the depositors of all the elephant dung around here. I was actually hoping some might move towards that waterhole. So we're going to do another big loop and then head back. Have one last look at the lioness, if There hasn't been any movement. The cubs are still in that thicket. We're going to leave the area. Try again in the morning. Andre, wasn't this termite mound that we sat upon and got elephants right up next to us? I think it was. See, this big termite mound, Jean-André and I were in bushwalk. The grass was much higher, giving us a bit more cover. And we sat up there, and the elephants literally walked about 5 meters from us while we were sitting on top of that big termite mound. That was a very pleasant morning, wasn't it? Red Dog has got another question about elephants and is wondering, do the bulls communicate as much as the females? I'd probably say they communicate a bit less to sort out, but they do definitely communicate quite a lot. But I would say just because of the dynamic that happens in a breeding herd, there probably has to be more communication by the females. Actually, don't think I've driven on this road since I've been back from leave, so good to catch up, see if there's anything new happening in the area. So far, no signs of anything. Hi, Mia. Mia says, come on, Brent, find a porcupine, pangolin, and aardvark, please. I'll definitely try my best, Mia. And unfortunately, all three of those species, this is probably about the worst time of the day to look for them. So maybe as it gets a little bit darker, we might have a little bit of luck in that department. Surprised there. Not more sign of elephant at the moment. Look at that. There we go. Yellow-billed hornbill. They actually have very, very robust beaks, but they are able to be quite delicate with them. Can you hear the little tuk 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 tuk? Oh, off it goes. Oh. Anyway, a nice view of the yellow-billed hornbill. It seems like even the birds are on strike this evening. But that's how it goes in the bush. Sometimes there's just stuff happening everywhere. Other times you've got to work a little bit hard, and that's what makes it fun. Sorry guys, just gonna be on the radio.
that. All covered. Come on. There were so many lion tracks all over, Juma. I wonder where the rest of them are. Standing white orbs. Some male waterbuck. Fluffy antelope. Two young bulls. Now, waterbuck are one of our biggest antelope, and you can see the very distinctive white ring around their bottom. Makes them look like they've sat on a freshly painted toilet seat. Of course they haven't, it is a following mechanism, so they're able to follow each other through the bush. Now, Kathy's wondering, how do antelope out in Africa's sizes compare to deer and moose? Now, unfortunately for me, I don't really know that much about... I know red deer... Which a red deer, I think, is about very similar size to a waterbuck or a kudu in weight. Now, a moose is probably the same size as a buffalo, is the best way I could say. And an impala is about the same size as a white-tailed deer. So I think red deer and elk are similar sized. So a big male waterbuck or a big male kudu is similar size to an elk or a red deer. But a moose, probably the size of a buffalo. I think moose can get probably 700-800 kilograms in weight, and that is about the same size as our buffalo. But we're going to leave the little waterbucks as they meander off. We're going to do the same, keep checking through this area. Hi, Monique. Monique says, how about finding us a snake? Apparently today is World Snake Day. I didn't know that, Monique. I'll have to post a picture of a snake for World Snake Day when I get home. I'll try my best, but again, also this time of the year, not the most ideal time to be looking for snakes. Most of them are hibernating to a degree in this cold winter weather. We might get lucky, you never know. Well, it seems like they've fixed Carrot's earpiece, so let's go see what they're up to. I'm sure they're going to be hot on the heels of Shadow.
We have indeed, and I have marvellous news. Not only does Carrot now have communications with the outside world, aka Jerry, who is talking in our ears, but we are heading straight back to where we heard those alarm calls. Even better news, Herbert is going to be with us. So Herbert is racing along behind us. I hope not eating my dust. I didn't actually ask him which way he was planning on going. He is convinced that she has made a kill in there. Absolutely convinced. In fact, I just met him now outside the gate. It's like I told you, Jenny. I promise you she's got a kill in there. I'm going to take Herbert at his word because Herbert is a tracking legend. And we're going straight back to go and find this cat. So fingers crossed, everybody. We had such an incredible sighting with Shadow the last time I saw her. We had a sighting with her and her cub. And her cub is only 4 months old at this point. Too cute. And she'd caught a monkey. And the little cub was dragging the monkey around and chewing on it. And even went so far as to hiss at Mom when Mom tried to go and eat some of the food that she'd caught. An incredible sighting. So bear with me, everybody. We're going to go quite quickly. And we're not going to stop at the moment for most of the stuff we see, unless it's something extraordinary, or if it is a snake for Monique in London, since it is World Snake Day. I've been doing that all day. I don't know. There's a problem with my speech patterns. You should have heard me this morning trying to say cheetah planes pan. Cheetah pans plane. Yeah, okay. Let's move on. Let's go find Shadow. Okay. Such a picky. Such a pity. This is such a tricky block. This is ridiculous. Okay. Now, let me try and get my words straight. Michelle, good afternoon and welcome to the Sunset Safari. I'm afraid we don't have any updates on any of the other leopards. I know you are particularly speaking about Mvula. Last we heard, he was reunited once again with Shaluva, whether he wanted to be or not, I imagine. That's how I imagine it worked. So for those of you who missed it, Mvula, a big male leopard who used to be dominant in this area, has almost reached the stage where he's not been really holding territory. He's been pushed out of his territorial area. And he was mating with Shaluva. We then heard a report that he got into a fight with a male leopard called Gijima. He ran off, so did she. And they were then seen mating again last night in Buffleshoek, the property to the north of our boundary. Our chances are that scrap was... Well, it would have been a serious scrap by leopard standards, but it would have been very short-lived. They probably would have tangled for a little bit and then moved off, which is what they did by all accounts. So Mvula, I'm sure, is fine. He might have got a few knocks, he might be a bit scratched, but otherwise he seems to be happy and healthy. The reason I say that I don't think he had much choice in his reunion with Shaluva is that, as we've seen before, a female leopard in estrus, or in heat, can be quite a force to be reckoned with. They can be quite tricky to shake. Now, he may not have wanted to be mating with her. There's a great deal of noise, and he probably wouldn't have wanted to attract Gijima's attention once again. But I have a suspicion, this is pure supposition, but I have a suspicion she probably followed him. And the instinct to mate, obviously, once presented with a female in estrus, is relatively irresistible. But we did hear Gijima, a territorial calling up in Buffleshoek last night when we went to bed. Okay. Looking for a dust cloud that might mean Herbert is on his way behind us. Let us just check really carefully around the Balanites tree. This enormous torchwood that is one of the boundaries of Shadow's area. It's a beautiful tree. Stop here and just listen for a second. One day I'm going to come around this corner and there will be a leopard in this tree. I really feel like that is going to be the case. I always say that, though, every time I come past, and there never is. There is a squirrel, though. I had a sudden surprise. I thought that perhaps there was a leopard moving, but it's not. It's a squirrel. And he's disappeared as well, unfortunately. Right, Shadow, where are you? Oh, it's gone so quiet. Okay. Let's just check really carefully along this road. I'm with you, Paul. Hopefully with Herbert on the trail, we will have a leopard sighting shortly. Keep our fingers crossed that he can come and give us a hand. It definitely helps having two of us, because it means that we can make sure not that we don't miss her coming out somewhere odd. Okay. Check along here. I just wonder whether the elephants didn't chase her a little bit to the north. We're quite far away from where those alarm calls happen. I'm going to do a big loop and then go back to that region. Because there's one other possibility, and one is that it's something that Herbert suggested to me. There's a possibility that she actually stashed her cub, as leopards do when their cubs are, well, throughout their cubs' lives, but especially when their cubs are as young as Shadow's cub is. And they stash them away and they go off hunting. And there is a chance, there is a possibility that she's made a kill and she's going back to fetch her cubs. Because generally, when a leopard is feeding, they have a tendency to drag their kill under a thick tree or a bush or somewhere well hidden, if they can't put it up into a tree. And as a result, they don't actually get seen by the other animals of the area. So you don't often get the alarm calls responding to them unless they're moving. I want to know why Shadow was moving, where she might be going, and why on earth we haven't managed to spot her yet. I'm going to have to try and see. I think Herbert might have got distracted. He does have guests with him, so he's not 100% devoted to us. Not that that's a bad thing. Herbert is marvelous at all things. There's some very gentle squeaking coming from Wendy. Now, of course, the Shadow has become one of the most famous leopards in the world, and that is in part due to the situation that arose with her older cub, Sindile. Now, Sindile was the one that caught the dog that proved to have rabies, put into quarantine and then released not too long ago. And there was a very dramatic sighting with Sindile, Shadow, and Shadow's new little cub that played out in front of an audience of thousands not too long ago. And it had a very happy ending in that the cub proved to be absolutely fine, Shadow's younger cub, even though Sindile potentially was a threat to it. Now, yes, absolutely, Michael. Sindile is the only cub that Shadow has raised to adulthood, to independence. There's a lot of conjecture about what it is, because Shadow is Karula's oldest daughter. She's nearly 10 years old. She has never raised a successful litter apart from one cub. And yet her mother, Karula, in exactly the same area, has raised, in no particular order, Shadow and Tundi, Shimbambalana and Shinvinzi, Mishun and Duna, Quarantine and Kunuma, and now she's got another set that she is looking after very well. And there's a lot of conjecture about whether or not Shadow is in fact a bad mother. I struggle with that. I'm not sure it's that easy to label a leopardess bad, although a very convincing argument that was put to me was that surely they animals have skills, just like human beings have skills and talents, and perhaps mothering is one of Karula's. Certainly, Karula is an exception to a statistically very, very high mortality rate for cubs. I don't know. The one thing that Shadow really doesn't do well is she doesn't hoist her kills. She doesn't drag her kills up into a tree. And that in turn attracts the attentions of hyenas and automatically puts the cubs slightly more at risk. I don't know whether I would call Shadow a bad mother. An unlucky one, absolutely. She's been tremendously unfortunate in terms of her cub raising. But is there a reason why she doesn't hoist her kills as much as Karula? And is it possible that hyenas have learnt which leopard they might have a better success rate in terms of scavenging from? We know that hyenas can and do follow leopards around occasionally, even adult leopards, just out of curiosity to go and see if they have got a kill. Is it possible that hyenas could learn certain individuals are not as good at hiding their food away as others? I don't know. That might be a little bit of a stretch, but hyena are very, very clever animals. Come on, Shadow. It's so quiet out here. It's too quiet. There's not an impala. No warthog. There is everything. And we have a, as always, we usually gather one or two new viewers every single drive. And it is our pleasure this afternoon to welcome Emma Thompson, who is watching our show live. Emma Thompson, it's wonderful to have you on board. I am assuming that you are probably not the great British actress Emma Thompson. Somehow I can't imagine that in taking time off writing screenplays and whatever else Emma Thompson does these days, but I could be wrong. Perhaps we have gathered the great Emma Thompson onto our viewing list. Not that you would be any less welcome if you are not, in fact, the great British actress Emma Thompson. And I really hope we manage to find this leopard for you. It will be a very, very pleasant afternoon if we do. So welcome to Emma Thompson. Don't forget, we are live twice a day, every day. 3 hours in our morning, 3 hours in our afternoon. And you are more than welcome to send through any questions that you have on the wildlife of South Africa. Please don't feel shy, and certainly don't feel as if the question you're asking is stupid. We do have viewers that have been watching for years and years, but as I said, we always have new viewers jumping on board as well. And sometimes we get a little bit sort of caught up in the excitement and we forget that there are newer viewers watching. Perhaps we don't explain ourselves as clearly, so please, Emma, shout if you want us to expand upon something more. I'm becoming very, very familiar with this patch of road now. I've driven it a lot in the last few hours. All right. Mm-hmm. So, Gert is going to give us a quick windscreen wipe. It is live, as you know, and we are in the middle of winter, which means dust has been piling upon us, especially while I raced back to camp. So the odd windscreen wipe is entirely forgivable, and I'm sure you'd entirely appreciate it. You should see what happens when it rains out here. Constant wiping of lenses. Now, typically, with our beloved leopard cubs, because of the incredibly high mortality rate, we generally do not name them before they have reached a year old, because that's the point at which their survival chances steadily increase, or actually dramatically increase. However, we broke the rules with Karula's cubs for a couple of reasons. Most importantly was that we were concerned because the guides, we didn't want them to get unofficial names that then became almost like official names and to actually usurp the naming rights of the various guides in this area. So Karula's 5-month-old cubs got their names a little bit earlier than would be normal, and they were named Hosanna and Shungile, which I think are really lovely names. I really enjoy those names. Deborah, who is our self-professed armchair traveller, as always a warm welcome to you. No word on the naming of Shadow's cub. The guides of the era, I think, agreed to naming them a little bit earlier, to naming Karula's cubs a little bit earlier, because she spends an enormous amount of time with us. I think they might have, well, I don't know. I mean, we didn't really ask them if we could name Shadow's cub earlier. We focused more on Karula's cubs. Not for any major reason, other than it's just simply that we don't see Shadow as often as we see Karula. So we haven't asked about naming them early. That's not to say that we won't. It's not to say that we will. But no, there is no update on the naming of Shadow's cub. James, of course, with his royalist leanings, having nicknamed Karula's cubs George and Charlotte, decided that Shadow's cub should be called Zara. Just in keeping with the theme, those of you who are British will understand. I have to confess, I quite like the name Zara, but I seriously doubt, and please keep it as an unofficial name, because I seriously doubt that's one that's going to stick. We've got the kudu here. We've got some kudu here. And they now look perfectly relaxed with life. They were not here when we last drove this road. So I don't know if these are the individuals responsible for the deep and booming bark that we heard earlier, that alarm call. They don't even seem to be glancing in any particular direction. I wonder. There's a whole load of them in here. As always with kudu, the more you look at, the more you see. Definitely one of our most graceful antelope, and they have a distinct advantage over the impala of this area in that they are much, much higher. So they can actually see over the strychnos. Hello, girls. I bet you know exactly where the leopard is. Hello, beautiful. Have you seen a leopard? I think you have seen a leopard. I wish you could tell us where she might be, though. They definitely don't look unsettled in any way. While we look at them in their favourite habitat, the white stripes, as always, jump out at the eye. And this morning we spoke about the blue wildebeest and the fact that they have darker stripes. And in both cases, it's thought that the stripes act to break up the outline of the animal concerned. And as always, welcome to James Richards. And no, I have absolutely no idea what factors might have favoured the evolution of white stripes on kudu over wildebeest dark stripes. Except you might be right, it might be habitat preference. Certainly the wildebeest have the females have horns because they live, or there's a strong correlation with that fact and the fact that they live in more open areas, as opposed to our kudu, where the females don't have horns and live in much more densely vegetated areas. That could well be a factor. There might be a bit of chance as well. I'm not 100% sure, and I honestly don't know the answer to that. Let me go back a little bit. Now, I'm just going to go back one more time. I want to see if they're glancing back in a direction at all. Excuse me, girl. Have you by any chance seen the leopard? There's also a herd of impala. They look perfectly relaxed. She doesn't really mean that she isn't here. It just means that they are no longer concerned about the presence of a leopard. I'm going to loop around, go back to where we heard the kudu alarm calling, because they weren't alarm calling from here. I was here when I heard them. I'm going to go see whether or not a shadow has popped out. In the meantime, let's head across to Brent for an update.
We just stopped for a quick listen around the southern edge of our traverse, and I was hoping we might hear a kudu alarming. Might not. Jamie's off in the west looking for shadow and cub. We went back past that lioness, and there was no movement there, and the other vehicles were wanting to get in there, so we left. So I just think that... Oh, it's a hyena track. That's been half driven over. So I did get an update today from the guys in the Manuleti. So just near the gate, just beyond Sydney's dam, it seems that is where the hyena den is at the moment. So in the Manuleti, just outside of the Sabi Sands. Of course, they'll still range into the Sabi Sands while foraging, but hopefully they'll move back to the Juma dens soon. Now, we might head across to Arethusa. I was on my way to go try see what the dam was looking like when we were lucky enough to hear those impala and monkeys alarm calling on yesterday's sunset safari and find Salahesh. And now, for those who are not sure, Salahesh is a female leopard who's traditionally been further to the west and south of our traverse area. But now that her cub has become independent, she seems to be moving into Shadow's territory. Look here. This is a favorite spot of Karulas to cross. Unfortunately, no tracks. Well, lots of tracks, just no leopard tracks. Oh! Change of plans. I copy, thanks Andrew. Yeah, I'm on Gari Main Junction, Chila Katla, and I'd also like to make my way. Okay, so I just got a report from the east, and I was umming and ahhing with Jandre whether we should head east. Our decision has now been made for us, and I'm not going to tell you what's there. So you're going to have to guess or hope or pray it's what you want to see. On our way, or as we make our way towards Cheetah Plains, and while we do that, we're going to have to go through a few little deep drainage lines where we don't have signal. So while we shoot to the east, let's go back and see how Jamie's hunt for the elusive shadow is going.
Hello everybody, just bear with me 1 second. I just want to have a quick chat with yours and his guests, and I'll be with you in 2 moments. Though those alarm calls are coming from here, in here somewhere. Herbert is convinced she's got a kill. Some. Oh, awesome. Okay. Cool. Enjoy. I'll let you know if we have any luck here. Okay. Cheers, guys. Okay. On we go. Sorry about that, everybody. While Brent races across to the surprise, which. I'm not sure if you heard that, but I think we might have an idea about what the surprise may be, unfortunately. I think the cat might have just gone out of the bag quite literally at that point. Okay. So yours came from that direction, clearly, judging by his tire tracks. One more loop, and then we'll expand the search, we'll move on. And we will try and find you other wonderful things to look at. I'm just very, very reluctant to give up right this second on a potential shadow sighting. And Charlotte in Port Elizabeth and Kathy in Tennessee have come to the same conclusion. It's something I suggested in a fireside chat, and I got some odd looks when I did. But I don't think it's outside of the realm of possibility. Just chatting a bit about our wonderful shadow's lack of hoisting ability. This is where I heard the alarm calls, by the way, so I'm concentrating really hard, making sure that she hasn't popped out somewhere here. So their suggestion was my suggestion, which might be that she has some kind of physical disability that would prevent her from hoisting large kills. Perhaps I really genuinely feel that's a possibility. I don't think it's that she doesn't know how to, because she's hoisted smaller things like dakas or steenbokks. Maybe she's just weaker than Karula. That's a possibility. Maybe she suffered some kind of injury. perhaps an injury to her jaw that would make it difficult for her to pull something heavy into a tree. I don't know. The one thing I will say, though, is that Tundi hasn't really had much in the way of success either. She's also, as far as I know, she's also only raised one cub to independence. Maybe two. There's some debate about that. Hey, look, it's our Impala. Hello, guys. You don't look any more concerned than when we last looked at you. Not unfortunately, it's not that I wish terror upon them, but they might have been able to give us a clue as to where a shadow might be. I don't know that it's outside of the realm of possibility that Shadow has an injury or some kind of disability. It's possible. Might just be that she is just weaker. She just doesn't have the physical strength. We may never know. Impala are looking off into the distance. Interestingly enough, in this situation, it looks as though the ram has collected a harem. Now, his timing at least is a little bit off, because the breeding season is now over. The rutting season is now over. The females are no longer in estrus or in heat. I'm not sure he's going to have much in the way of luck there with his group of ladies, but he really does appear to have gathered a group. You see how they're all crowded together? And he is off to the right, hidden at the moment behind the trees, but he is off to the right, keeping a very close eye on them. He's definitely got his timing all wrong. Now, they do look absolutely beautiful in this colour. I must say, this time of year, whilst it is very dry, what you're all looking at, they're not 100% relaxed. They do keep looking off into the distance. Maybe, just maybe, she's still around. Just have a feeling she's somewhere here. But where I was going to go with that sentiment before I got distracted was, although it is very dry, it is actually a really beautiful time of year. The Impala show up bright red against the yellow background, and when the sun is just right, whether it's setting or rising, you get the most extraordinary golden orange to the atmosphere. It really is beautiful. Okay, who wants to go to the Gowri repeater? You guys can have a little behind the scenes glimpse as to what's going on. I'm going to go to the Gowri repeater and just see if there's no sign of Shadow there. And as we go along, we're going to try and check every termite mound that we can see. Perhaps there's a chance that Shadow's up there. And I switched my comms to Arethusa just to listen for any sign of Shadow. Maybe I missed her crossing Triple M. And I'm going to go back so that Herbert can contact me. Now, just talking about Shadow's mothering skills, Carol in Atlanta, very good point from you, which is how much has to do with the territories that the leopardesses hold, whether it is to do with prey concentrations, other leopards around, hyenas, lion concentration, and so on. It's a very, very valid point, and definitely, if you were to take a cross-section from one part of the Sabi Sands, one part of the Kruger National Park, and compare it to another, you would definitely find a difference. However, I think that Karula and Shadow's territories are too close together for that to necessarily be a deciding factor. The reason I say that is the lion concentration, I mean, they share a boundary. The lion concentration is essentially the same. Hyenas, again, essentially the same. And the habitat is almost identical. But that's a very, very good point. And there is a chance that that would definitely play a rate in cub's success and survival rate. In a place where there are no lions and no hyenas, there will be a much higher success rate than there would be for others. And of course, the biggest killer, 50% of known cub deaths, and that's where the key lies, 50% theoretically of known cub deaths are caused by male leopards, which is a very strange thing for us as human beings to wrap our heads around. Okay, we have arrived at the Gowrie Repeater. This, of course, plays an enormous role in our abilities to send out and do a live game drive from the middle of the African bush. We shall do a brief look at it. It gives me a chance to scan the area for any leopards in marula trees. Watch heads. Sorry, Gert. And there we go, the Gowrie Repeater, but not much else here. No sign of any tracks. And all quiet. Okay. The Gowrie Repeater. It wasn't what I was intending on showing you. I was really hoping we might have Shadow. But no sign of her here. And so I think it's time for us to move on to the from the area and see what other things we can find. We'll go and check water, just in case she's moved across there. And we'll see. Maybe we missed her tracks. I'm convinced she's in here, though. It's just such a big area for us to be able to scour. And with elephants everywhere, we can't really be off on foot for too long. We've been looking at the signs and the different animals, trying to gauge from their behavior whether or not there's a chance of spotting a leopard. And Lucy, yes, absolutely, you are right in that animals are always alert at all times, which you have to be, I suppose, when you're on somebody's menu. But Lucy's question is more, never mind, we'll get to Lucy's question in a moment. Brent has his surprise for you.
Look at that, isn't that absolutely gorgeous? And a favorite of a lot of our viewers. And isn't it wonderful to have a leopard in this golden light? Now, we are on Cheetah Plains, and this is, of course, Mr. Q. Now, he looks a little bit hungry, not too hungry, but he could definitely have a meal. Unfortunately, he is heading north at the moment. That is towards our boundary, but we will stay with him as long as we can. Now, Mr. Q seems to like taking Jandra and I on bumbles through the thickest of thick blocks. Now, we will try to stick with him. As you can see, it is quite an impressively thick block we're going into. Try stick with him through here. Now, we know how Mr. Quarantine loves a good termite mound. There's a good one coming up. Okay, Jean-Jacques. There we go.
man, look, this is going to be absolutely spectacular. Let me just get you in the right spot. Get our shadow out of the way. Oh, look at that. Mr. Q, true to form, loves a good pose. You hear that clickety-click? It's me also taking advantage of his posing. Now, I hope you guys are getting some fantastic screenshots of this. And if you are, don't forget to share them on our Facebook page, which is called Safari Live, or pop them on Twitter with the hashtag Safari Live. Said he looks a bit hungry. He has eaten, but he's by no means fat and full. Look at that. He is just a spectacular male leopard. He's around 4 years old now. Oh, there we go. Looking right at us with those gorgeous golden eyes. Cecilia says, Brent, please ask Quarantine where Shadow is hiding. You speak leopard, don't you? I wish you did. I wish I did, Cecilia. We'd have a lot more leopard sightings than we do already. And this is just absolutely gorgeous. Jean-Dre, would you like me to move a bit forward so we can try to get him right in front of him? When? How's that? Oh, magic. Oh, he's on the move. Look at this, he's right next to me. He's literally a few feet from me. He's going so close to the vehicle we can't see him. There he is. Now, he is one of Karula's progeny, and he has grown up around vehicles. He is possibly one of the most relaxed leopards I've ever spent time with. I'm going to try to keep up with him. Does sometimes take us through some quite challenging areas, and it's things like that you can barely see that really damage your vehicles. But I'm just trying to see where he's gone. John, is he still heading straight north or a bit further east? 11 o'clock, so straight north. Try not go over things like that. There's another termite mound up ahead that he might be heading straight for. You a quick look before we try to get a bit closer. So this is his very, very common for male leopards or leopards in general to move termite mound to termite mound. utilizing them as high ground to see for potential prey. It looks like he's going to lie down for a bit. Okay, let's get a bit closer. I do love spending time with this particular leopard, although his brother was my favorite. Light, not the silhouette. Cool. There we go. So a lot of you guys sending your screenshots already. Thanks very much. Look at this, and you're going to get a few more. He really does like a good pose, Mr. Quarantine. Type of leopard you can snap off a whole card on. It just gives you so many great photographic opportunities. You can actually see his neck is thickened and he is turning into a beautiful big boy. He's starting to lose a bit of that puppy fat. He's starting to look like a bit of a bruiser. Look at that. A beautiful late afternoon light on half of his face. So it is nice that we're seeing so much of him again. When I first started at Safari Live, we used to see a lot of him on Juma. He's checking around. There could be some potential prey up ahead. He's listening. Marsha in Oklahoma is wondering if this guy's brother, Kunyuma, is as successful as Quarantine has become in this area. It seems to be the reports I get from down to the south that he's done well. The big male who was dominating over the area he's in was actually killed by lions recently. So he got a bit of a lucky break there. Oh, he's tired. No, not quite comfortable enough yet. Look at that magnificent profile. You can see what I'm talking about. His neck is thickening. He's getting much, much bigger. He's losing a bit of that sort of puffy young face, and he's starting to develop that sort of almost a bruiser look about him. Someone not to be trifled with. He's very big for a four-year-old leopard. Now, he's having a little cat nap. Oh, there we go. Making himself comfortable on his paws. Now, Valeria would like to know, at 4 years old, is he considered to be in his prime? No, Valeria, he's still quite young. Leopard prime for 6 to 10 years old. So he's still a bit off being in his prime, but he is a very big male leopard for this age. Jen's wondering, where is brother Kanuma hanging out? He is hanging out on Londolozi near the Sand River, the last information I heard. So while we sit here and see, wait for quarantine to get mobile again, let's go to Jamie, who's got the smallest carnivore in Africa.
From one of our biggest cats to one of our smallest predators, we've got a group of sunbathing dwarf mongoose on Knobthorn Open. This is a band of mongoose that we have become quite familiar with over the last few months. We see them pretty much every time we drive along this road. And we've arrived just in time for their evening grooming and bonding session, as well as soaking up the last rays of the sun before the temperature drops and it's time for them to disappear into their termite mound home, where they will spend the rest of the evening. Look at the bundle on the left there, having a marvellous time grooming each other. It's known as allo-grooming, so grooming themselves but then also grooming each other. And it's a very, very important part of their social bonding. And that is essential for a group that lives and relies upon... oh, there was a quick armpit clean there on the right. Relies upon the bonds of their group in order to survive. Using their sharp little teeth to comb through the fur and clear away any parasites that may have gathered. It's a very cute scene that's unfolding in front of us. Putting those fierce little fangs to good work. Look at that one at the back on the left. It's got a scar on it. In fact, a couple of these guys have scars. I wonder if they haven't been involved in a skirmish with another band of dwarf mongoose, or another business of dwarf mongoose. All gathering together, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 of them. 8 of them, I think, actually. There was a head that popped up that I didn't see initially. Generally, as with the primate societies, the higher-ranking individuals get the most grooming from the rest of the group than others, if that makes sense. So the higher-ranking you are, the more likely you are that the others are going to groom you as a way of placating and winning favor, essentially. Oh, look at them. They really do have a lot of scars. Generally, a dwarf mongoose family tends to be a non-violent place when it comes to each other. So it's not like the lions where they fight over meals, they fight for dominance. The dwarf mongoose don't have that approach. But there really are a few scars here that probably was inflicted by other mongoose. Oh, it's okay, little one. Oh, shame. It's all right. You can come. Promise you we don't bite. We've got one on the other side that I think is really wanting to go and join the rest of the group, but finds itself in a difficult position in that there is a great big obstacle in front of it. That, of course, being us. I can't. I feel guilty. We have to go back. We have to go backwards. I mean, not that it's that hard to go around, but shame. I feel guilty. All right, little one. Let's go see. Let's go back a bit and see if that doesn't help encourage a bit of movement from this little chap. Oh, he's darted off undercover for now. There you go. Okay, there's a nice open spot for you. As you were. Vanished. Oh. Here we are. It's okay. You can come. You can come through. Come on, little one. Okay, we're just going to sit nice and still. And that will relax them. And dwarf mongoose tend to be relatively bold creatures. Curious and get comfortable very quickly with the presence of other vehicles. So we will just wait for that little one to come. In the meantime, we will watch the rest of the group. But before we do, Cheese on Toast. Fantastic name, by the way, Cheese on Toast. I'm a big fan of Cheese on Toast. Cheese on Toast would like to know whether or not mongoose and meerkats are related. Yes, absolutely. Hey, there we go. Shot across in front of us and rejoined the rest of the group. Just to make you all feel better, the little chap off to the right there, that's our mongoose. He's gone across to join them. Well done, little guy or girl. Cheese on Toast? Yes, absolutely. Meerkats are related to mongoose. They all fall under the Herpestidae family, to be precise. And essentially, a meerkat is, it's basically a type of mongoose. It's a mongoose that is adapted to live in very arid area, in desert areas, with a very, very similar social structure to the dwarf mongoose that we watch in this area. So we don't get meerkats here, but it's very, very similar. They are much, much larger than our little dwarf mongoose, but they are not too much larger than the banded mongoose that we also get here, and that's also a social form of mongoose. A shame, it was actually a little one. It is a almost fully grown, but not quite fully grown little dwarf mongoose. Okay, I'm going to reposition again back to our original spot now that our straggler has rejoined the group. We talk about our dwarf mongoose. Never mind, over to Brent. Let's see what Quarantine's up to.
I just spotted a duiker. The duiker came running in towards us. And he just spotted it and he shot off that termite mound. No, I didn't see where the duiker went. It was running parallel to him. So we're going to sit tight for now.
No, looks like he's lost interest. But it was enough to get him up off the termite mound. He just literally sprinted down. He's now mobile north again. Okay, we're gonna try to stick with him. But as you can see, this is a relatively challenging area. I'm trying to find a gap through here, there's one. Or is it? Not really. This termite mound right in front of us. It's a bit smaller than the ones he has been using, so he might not. Oh, he is going to. He's going to pop up right opposite us. He is moving north. And that's not ideal for us. Smelling, that's where the diker might have been sleeping before it dashed through. Yeah, good stuff. It also could possibly be a scent mark from another leopard. Good sniff around that little grivia bush. Oh, he's on the move again. I'm in a bit of a predicament here. Let's see if we can get out of it. Still see him, Jean-Dre. Past yours. Okay. Hold on. Trying to see. Ah, there we go. Got him. Okay, I'm going to try and get up ahead of him. It's going to be quite difficult to stick with him. He is getting very close to our northern boundary. Jean-Dre, you looking for me? Ah, got him. Okay. Of course, he's gone through the thickest of the thick there, just to the left of us. I'm hoping we're going to get him popping out right here. Well, let's hope he heads for that large termite mound. But I think he's got was sort of coming out a little bit further to the west. You see him, Jean-Dre? Okay, so this is a bit of guesswork. I've gone quite far ahead to see if we can jump ahead of him. Let's keep my eye open. He has gone into a very, very thick thing. Everyone's had to come out wide and around. I think I saw, it's a bird. I just saw a flash. of movement. Oh, here we go. Well done, Jandre. So we did choose the right spot. He's heading straight towards us. Looks like he stopped for a think and a smell and a scent mark. Now this is very unusual for a leopard of his age to be scent marking so profusely. And he's going to be in competition with his half brother, Shavambalan. Oh, he is just gorgeous. Look at that. Oh, they move so gracefully. So he's going to come right next to Jandre. Right behind us. Oh, beautiful. So yeah, we might go for that big termite mound. Unless he spots something else. Look just beyond him. You see that very fast moving... You know, there, stay there, Jandre. Just when he moves his head, you'll see just beyond it. Mm. Did you see that very fast moving thing there? Mm. I think it was a little battis alarm calling. A little bird in there that's not very happy with his presence. Let's try. Of course, he has chosen a particularly nasty block. I want to see if he's not moving towards that termite mound. I'm going to go up and around again. I don't feel like bashing through the thick of the roads right here. Of course, this road is unfortunately also our northern boundary. You might get your VR wish. I think he's going to walk straight on this path. So I don't know if you want to roll now. As he comes, we can try. He's going to go a little bit wide. No, he might come right up to us. Okay, I'm just going to... Oh. Oh, Jandre, panic. Panic, Jandre. Push the button, Jandre. Jandre's panicking. No, we have a GoPro malfunction. It's okay. It's not your fault, Jandre. It's just concentrate on the leopard. So he's heading right now towards the northern edge of our traverse area. And I think he is going to cross the boundary, unfortunately. But it's still been great to catch up with him. And about to step out onto the road. And across our boundary. Oh, he could change his mind at the last minute. I doubt it, but oh, we can have some wishful thoughts. Maybe he'll head a little bit further to the east. Bye-bye, Mr. Q. we're going to have to leave him be. He's heading now deep into coral. Let's try to see if we get one last nice view from the road. And then we're going to make space for other vehicles here. There we go. There you go, a leopard in a hat. Not something you see in the same shot every day. Oh, a leopard in hair as well. So he's crossed out of our traverse zone. He's definitely on the hunt. Hopefully he makes his way back towards Cheetah Plains to hunt. He's going to zigzag through this mixed broadleafed woodland at the moment. Using that termite mound to survey around. Definitely on the hunt. And weren't we lucky to spend that time with him in that beautiful golden light a little bit earlier? Well, he posed so nicely for us atop a termite mound. Just carefully checking around. You might lie down on this termite mound and we might carry on hunting. He's going to carry on. I think that's the last visual we're going to get of him for this evening's sunset safari, but it has been quite spectacular. And while we've been following him, it's got a bit cold. And I was too excited about following the leopard to put my jersey on. I'm going to take that opportunity now quickly. And there was a nice herd of elephants around three in a row pan. We'll go see, I think we might have missed them while we've been following the leopard, but we'll go have a look anyway. Oh, look at that. Beautiful sight. Not quite as beautiful as the leopard, but nonetheless, I'll let Jandre choose his sunset this time. Although, I think it's quite average, Jandre. We could have done a bit better if you'd just let me go a bit further. There we go. The African sun setting. Isn't that exquisite? Okay, Jandre, I'll take it back. It's quite a good sunset. You can actually see as Jandre darkens, you can see some sun spots. Isn't that incredible? One, two, three that I can see. And the sun is not broken. It's not shattering. That's just a little stick that's in between us and the sun on the left-hand side of the screen. Wow, isn't that amazing? Lovely. Okay, let's move towards the pan before we lose all our light. Oh, that was wonderful. I do love spending time with Quarantine. He's always such good value. And that's the nice thing about young male leopards. They're always up and active, or a lot more up and active than an adult male. Adult male generally just tends to march, hunt, scent mark, march, hunt, scent mark. Now, someone was asking whether quarantine had any offspring yet. And Tasha, here we are. Hi, Tasha. Not yet. He's still too young to hold the territory, although he's behaving like he holds territory. So maybe he'll get lucky enough to mate before he's five. But at the moment, it's not impossible, but just very unlikely that he has any offspring just yet. Now, Gen B is wondering how big is quarantine in comparison to Tengana. I would say he's probably still 65 to 70 kilograms, whereas Tengana is probably 80 to 85 kilograms. So in terms of height, they're about the same size, but quarantine is yet to fill out. Okay, so on our way down here, we dashed past the elephants to get to quarantine. He was heading through into that thick block, so we managed to get there just in time. Just want to see if any of the elephants are still hanging around at the three in a row pan. While we go do that, let's go see what Jamie's been up to.
Well, we might not have had any luck with Shadow, but at least you got to see her younger brother. I was going to say little brother, but younger brother I think is a better description. Quarantine, the lovely male leopard that I actually encountered for the very first time just a few days ago. It's the one and only time I've ever seen him. Quarantine, as far as I understand, was named after quarantine clearings, and it was just before I started working here on Juma that he actually dispersed and moved away from his mother's territory. And speaking of his mother, I've moved outwards from my search for Shadow, although I am going to return to that area. I've just been doing very, very large loops around it, hoping that perhaps I've missed something, but I haven't. I know she's in there somewhere. The block where four guides spent 4 hours tracking Shadow, including Herbert, and never managed to find her not so long ago. So a very, very tricky spot, and I'm relatively certain that is where she is. Oh, very bouncy spot over there. And we're going to search instead for Shadow's mother for now, and then slowly make our way back into that area. What I'd really, really like to do is go up towards Sydney's Dam, in the hope, I know that Brent has shared the news about our hyena den on Manuleti, kind of in the hope that they might have decided to pop out around there, just pop out around the dam, I mean. But unfortunately, I don't think Wendy will quite make it that far north. She's a little bit limited as to where she can go. Oh, well, it seems as though Elephant's prediction came... No! What is wrong with me today? Brent's prediction of elephants came true. Let's head across to him.
Oh, well, we're literally surrounded by elephants at the moment. That one's having a scratch. Quickly in front of us, Chandra. Two boys. Look at that. Two young boys having a bit of a wrestle. Actually, yeah, their tusks hitting each other. I don't think that game's over yet. Well, we can see who's winning, and it's the one on the left. They are creating a fair amount of dust. Now, I wonder, just come wide again, Jandre. He's still stalking, that other bull is still stalking the other one. Look at that. Oh, isn't that amazing? Now that's swagger.
I want to get a bit closer. I'm quite interested in the dynamic that's happening with those two bulls.
I will come back to the rest of the herd, but I think there might be a bit more action around those two again. Oh, sorry, little one. Watching all the other elephants all around us. Large stumpy oven glove at 3 in a row. Okay. Nope. I just want to watch what happens between these two. Found the water pipe, or the old water pipe, and is wondering why there is no fresh water coming out of it. I still think... Just playing. Blowing bubbles. Now here we go, this is what I was waiting for. I didn't think that game was quite over yet. Ooh, see, it's a bit more playing, although these boys are probably mid to late 20s. Oh dear, what's going on? Oh. I thought there might be a little bit more action. See, the smaller elephant has chosen the higher ground, standing above, trying to take advantage of that. There we go. It's not too serious. It's more playful than anything else. Oh, push you into the water. These young bulls are so much fun, especially when in this type of mood. Oh. They're going to go make some big mud splashes shortly. Right, just playing. Fantastic creatures to spend time with. Now, what an apt description by Lynn. They're like two teenage boys messing around. That suits this sort of scenario perfectly. Now, who's going to make the first move? Stalemate. Oh, there we go. Oh, I was trying to entice a bit of tussling. Look from his wet trunk that he's putting on his forehead. He's now got war paint on. Looks like they've hit a bit of a stalemate. Let's go see what the rest of the herd are doing behind us. Oh wait. Okay, no, maybe let's stay with these two for a bit longer. There we go. As we're saying, not too serious, just two young boys playing around. Oh. Now they're right opposite us now. Now the one on the left looks like it could be slightly older, but smaller in body size. Now, this is very playful, not serious, but an elephant fight can get very serious. So they're about to walk behind us. Oh, you just sort of just noticed us here. So we're going to have to turn the car around while we do that. Jamie's got some other animals that are locking their horns in this case.
I really wanted to show you what the Impala rams were doing. They were fighting as well, so I thought I was going to sort of lead with there must be something in the air in the Sabi sands tonight. Unfortunately, our Impala, right at that moment, true to the joys of live wildlife filming, decided to stop sparring. So much for that idea. It was a good idea while it lasted, from fighting elephants to fighting Impala. They've all completely relaxed, and off they go. We have some zebra to show you instead. If you'll bear with me one moment, they've also decided to go behind the tree. So all in all, it's gone fabulously around Treehouse Dam. The animals are not on our side today. Well, no, that's not quite true. We just haven't been very lucky today. Let's go forward a little bit for our zebra stallions. In the hope that we can provide you with a good reason to have taken you away from Brent's elephants temporarily. There you go, our zebra looking, as always, incredibly picturesque in the evening light. Standing by. No, it was west of the antenna. A little bit further in towards that block, maybe even a little bit northwest, but it was west of that antenna. Sorry, guys, just chatting to Herbert about where the alarm calls were. Right, I'm going to, in that case, since our Impala have stopped fighting and our zebra is presenting us with a rear view, I don't want to take you away from Brent's elephants for too long, so back you go, right back to Cheetah Plains.
fighting over. Now it's time to throw dust on oneself. Now a third bull has joined us. There's his bottom. And he seems to just be playing with the water a little bit. Not really drinking, just sort of sucking and spraying. Oh, he's going to have a drink now. Slightly older, slightly bigger. I'd say he's early 30s. Hey, big boy. Almost looks like he's giving me a little mischievous look, like he wanted to come shake his head at the car. Now, while we've been following these bulls around, the rest of that breeding herd has moved off into the bush, and it looks like the bulls are going to join them. I'll stick with them while we can. Wonderful spending time amongst Africa's giants. I do love Ellie's, especially the boys. Looks like they're going to head off for a night's feeding now. Had a nice little drink down at the pan, and they're going to spread through this woodland now. Isn't this awesome? We're just slowly moving parallel to this big boy. Hello, Yule. He changed his mind, he wants to cross the road. Off after the breeding herd. Well, we're going to let these ellies move off and continue on with their nocturnal foraging. Oh, there's another one coming. Is he going to follow? Or is he going to stay on the peripheries? This is one of the young wrestlers. No, looks like he's going to move. I'll try to keep up with him. Oh, I think he might stop for a scratch. Scratching his tummy against the wood. He can't be that itchy. Oh, yes, he is that itchy. He's going to sit on the log. So quite often they'll get ticks and things stuck in their groin there. And scratching on sticks like that help them to remove those ectoparasites. It looks like he's going to follow the other ellies.
So Sheen's wondering, what was the meaning of the gesture, the one Ellie was showing earlier, holding his trunk on his forehead? I don't think there was any meaning to it. I think he was just playing. So we're going to let these Ellies move off into the west, and we're going to start heading back towards the north. But Cheetah Plains has fortunately delivered for us on this sunset safari. Bad mister. What branches are you breaking there? There we go. Oh, yes. Not the bravest, that elephant. Deciding Jandre was far too scary for him to hang around here. So we're going to start making our way back towards the north, which is Juma, and see what we can find on our way. Hopefully we can find some little nocturnal critters that are going to start coming out now at the dusk. While we start heading north, let's go see how Jamie is doing.
Jamie has headed back to the west. I've got some very exciting but also vaguely frustrating news for you, and that is that Herbert found very, very fresh tracks around the repeater. So where we went this afternoon, she popped out there with her cub in that area. So Herbert's convinced, still convinced she's got a kill somewhere there. We must have just missed out on seeing her. And unfortunately now, it's that little bit too dark for us to go back there and have a look for her, because we can't, and we won't, spotlight a cub that is that young. Sadly, our search for Shadow ends for now, but at least we have a really good place to start for tomorrow morning's sunrise safari. Oh, it's one of those days where she was just so close and yet so far. Well, she probably was never far, she was probably always very close. It's just that difficult patch, and we must have just missed her. I'm trying to untangle my spotlight, there we go. Was caught up in my radios. So we'll continue on, we'll keep an eye out for her, but we won't go looking for her in that area with the spotlight. Now we've just got to hope that Shadow, on contrary to what we've been talking about earlier, we've got to hope that Shadow does in fact keep her kill this time around, safe from hyenas. Hopefully she hoisted, if in fact she does have a kill with her. And for now, we'll abandon the search and carry on looking for nocturnal creatures. And I think since we're here, let's go and investigate that bush baby nest that is not far from us at all. See if they've been spending their evenings there. The bush babies have a number of nests that they regularly utilize, but they don't stay in the same place every night. So what they'll do is they'll have a number of different places that they return to, but they'll move from place to place. And just by the way, on that subject, the dwarf mongoose that we saw, I encountered another group, another family, really, really close to where we spotted the other group, which means I think that we were right about the fact they might even be involved in a little bit of a territorial dispute. And that might explain the fresh scars that were on some of those mongoose that we saw. Ah, Shadow. Shadow in her favorite block. Oh, and that's a very good reminder from Jerry. Sorry, Miss Lynn, we got completely distracted by quarantine. I do hope you are still with us. We were just about to answer your question, and we had to rush you back across to quarantine. So Miss Lynn was asking whether or not, since we have dwarf mongoose, whether or not we have regular sized mongoose. And yes, we do. We have several different types of mongoose that we see, and in fact one of them is nocturnal, and one that we get really excited about seeing. So we get the banded mongoose, which I've managed to put on camera once very far away, and I think Scott managed to see them once on camera. But other than that, they are really incredibly tricky to spot. They're very, very shy. But they're about 1.5 times the size of your average dwarf mongoose. This is the bush baby nest. Let's just see for a second whether or not it pops its head out. But I think it's quiet for now. Little bush baby. We have been treated to the cutest sighting of bush babies in this spot before. Hello! Right on cue. What's going on? Could you have timed that more perfectly? How cool is that? Hello, little guy or girl. Thank you very much for that. At least the bush babies are playing along this afternoon. A very sleepy face poking out of its hole to investigate what's going on. Oh, no, I think I'll go back to bed instead. Not quite time for me to be awake. Almost. It is actually time for you to be awake, little bush baby. How cool is that? Just goes to show as well how comfortable they feel with the vehicle, because if that bush baby didn't feel comfortable, it wouldn't have popped its head out. How perfect was that timing? It was absolutely awesome. Sorry, Miss Lynn. Your question will get answered fully in one person. One more time? Yes, no? Little bush baby, want to come say goodnight to everybody and farewell? No, bedtime. Not quite ready to get out of bed just yet. Fair enough. I sometimes feel like that first thing in the morning, as I've said before at this particular bush baby nest. We leave our little bush baby in peace to pop out in the next few moments. It's exactly the right time for our bush baby to go out and start foraging. This is obviously a very well inhabited bush baby nest. Thanks for that, little one. That was an awesomely timed appearance. Okay, onwards. I think our little bush baby's going to stay in for now. Cool. Very special. And back to poor Miss Lynn and her question, since we seem destined to keep being interrupted. Miss Lynn, apart from the banded mongoose, we also get the slender mongoose, another very shy mongoose in contrast to the dwarf and the banded. It is entirely solitary, unless it has little ones with it or if it's mating. But other than that, you see them on their own, and you usually see the tail end of them disappearing into termite mounds, which is why we get really, really excited if we spot one. And then, of course, there is the white-tailed mongoose, the nocturnal species. We might, if we are really fortunate, and I found tracks of them once, and I had it confirmed with some of the other tracking experts in the area, that it was a white-tailed mongoose track. A water mongoose track, not a white-tailed mongoose track. So that was up near Sydney's Dam, and that's a water mongoose would be relatively unusual in this area. Another extraordinary sighting I had, unfortunately most definitely not on camera, it was on the way home from visiting friends in Simbombili, and that was a striped polecat, which is also relatively rare, same family or similar family as the mongoose and the meerkats. And that put an appearance, and we'll be very, very excited if we do spot one of those at some point. Now, the night holds all kinds of exciting secrets waiting to be found. That bush baby was a wonderful moment. Just little head peeking out and blinking sleepily at us. And yes, Jen Ward, that is exactly what that was. It is what, in Afrikaans, we call them bush babies in English, or, to be more correct actually, a lesser galago, hence the name Galago Camp, by the way. But that was indeed what they call in Afrikaans a nacharpie, a little night monkey, which I think is a really, really lovely descriptive name. A lesser galago or a nacharpie in Afrikaans. So whenever you add an IE sound to any Afrikaans word, or a key sound, depending on the word, then you basically, it's a diminutive. It's a little thing. A little cat is a cut is a kaiki, etc. It carries on like that, so that is a little night monkey. And that is, of course, what it is. It might not look it, but it is the tiniest primate that we get on in the Sabi sand. There's also a type of bush baby called a greater galago, or a thick-tailed bush baby, and that is much, much larger than its little bush baby cousin, than its lesser bush baby cousin, and they have a screech that is, that's where the name comes from. They sound like squealing babies, like a newborn infant screaming because it's hungry. That's what the thick-tailed bush baby sounds like, and unlike its the lesser bush baby, which spends most of its time foraging about in trees for gum, the thick-tailed bush baby spends a lot of time on the ground. Now, whilst we could get them here, and I think we'd be very excited if we did see them, they are much more, generally tend to confine themselves to areas with rivers, with permanent water sources, with enormous jackalberry canopies and leadwood canopies, fig trees. They tend to prefer those sorts of forested areas. But we don't really get them here. And there's a little family of bush babies that actually live at camp with all of us, and some they alternate between sleeping in the trees above what we call the Wendy House at DRC, or they live at Mike and Candace's house, our next door neighbors. And they sleep there, and the dogs, you know exactly when the lesser bush babies are sleeping at Mike and Candace's house, because their dogs are very good, they don't do anything. They just go and sit underneath the tree that they sleep in and stare up at them longingly. I also know lots and lots of places with habituated bush babies, something we've spoken about before. You don't really want to pet bush baby. They're terribly cute, but just bear in mind that their instinct is to put drops of urine on their hands and feet so that they can mark their territory. They will, whenever they cling onto you or jump on you, just remember where their feet have been. And Andreen, you wanted to know whether we have ever seen bush baby teeth. Am I correct in that? No, I don't think we've ever come close to, certainly not with me. I don't know whether we've ever managed to get close enough. Certainly with the camera that Brent has on his vehicle, we might be able to get a good glimpse of them if a bush baby were to give us a nice yawn. They have the bottom teeth that they utilize are actually quite specialized, used for grooming, so their incisors form a nice grooming ridge that they use to keep themselves clean. And as you can imagine, they do have quite sharp little teeth because they're omnivorous. At this time of year, most of their diet consists of gum or sap from the trees. And what they'll do is they'll go and find a nice spot where a beetle has bored into the bark, and they'll suck up the sap from there. But they do also catch and eat things like moths and insects, which in turn means that they need the kind of teeth that an animal would require to maintain that sort of diet. So quite sharp little teeth as well. Now, we had that perfect little spot for a bush baby to hide, but they don't necessarily sleep in holes. They will actually even find a tree branch where they will huddle all together. A couple of females and one or two males will all cuddle up together to spend their day asleep and safe. It has to be somewhere with plenty of cover though, because obviously there's a lot of animals that hunt during the day. Anything like the gymnogene or the harrier hawk that we saw today would be a regular predator of bush babies. Any raptor species, so they've got to pick a spot that is safe for them, and a hole like that is absolutely ideal. But they do not make the holes themselves. So what they will do is they will take over a hole that has been made already. And that question came through from Laura, watching in Pennsylvania. Laura, no, they don't make their own holes. And what they'll do is they a hollowed out dead branch, like the one that was in, was perfect. Because a woodpecker might come along and open up a hole there. Or, alternatively, something like a barbet is also capable of excavating its own holes. So generally, the little bush babies are relatively ill-equipped to create their own nest sites. Yes, they might definitely perhaps pick away at the bark, maybe hollow out, make it a bit more comfortable for themselves, but they don't excavate their own little nest sites. And perhaps if we keep monitoring that particular bush baby hole, there's a chance that we might even get to see little tiny bush baby babies, which is a bit tautologist, but you get what I mean. A bush baby baby would be one of the cutest things you can see out here. And they stay in their little hole until they are fully covered in fur, and then they go out with their mums. Yes, Chitra, spot on. The bush babies are in the same family as the slow lorises. They are put together, they're grouped together in all of the textbooks. The slow lorises and all the prosimians are all grouped. They're all part of the prosimian groups. And they are actually thought to be one of the most primitive forms of primate that have evolved. So that hand structure that they haven't quite got to the dexterity that monkeys and the apes have with the either partially or completely movable thumb. But they have got the basic prosimian hand structure, that grasping motion that they create, that they make. But yes, spot on, Chitra. Related very closely to the slow lorises. And there's one other primate that's in that family, and it's going to drive me mad. I will remember it. Just give me a moment to kick my brain into gear, because obviously it's been working so well this afternoon. Oh, what is the other one? I'm going to kick myself when I... You know when it's going to come to me? I'm going to wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning with my eyes wide open and go, oh, that was it. It's not a lemur, but it's something similar. Thank you, Gert. It's not a lemur. I'll remember, I promise. At some point I will remember. It'll come back to me. Sometimes I put too much information in my brain at once and it doesn't keep all of it. It's fine. I'll go and look it up to see. Oh, I've got full access to my library again as of today. So I'll go and double check it in my Estes book of Behavioral Guide of Mammals. He'll be able to tell me. Right. My mission over the next few days, and has been over the last few months, is to find you guys a porcupine. Dina, I'm really sorry. You've provided a suggestion that Jerry is desperately trying to give me, but I can't hear what she's saying. Sorry, Jerry, one more time. She's saying flops.
Flaps.
I don't know. Floss. Sloths! She's saying sloths! That's what she's saying. I'm sorry. No, Dina, they're not. But probably you'll find there's a common ancestor, though. But that's not what I'm thinking of. In terms of related to the bush babies. It's not a sloth. Sorry, Jerry. I don't know why I thought you were saying floss. That's what it came through. That's what it sounded like through the radio. I was trying to work out if there was some magical floss creature that I'd never heard of. No, Dina, I don't think it's not the sloths that I'm thinking of. It is actually difficult to say, enunciate properly in a South African accent. Definitely not Jerry's fault. That was entirely my fault. Well, guys, we will have to continue our discussion. I will go and look up what it is that I am trying to remember. And we will return tomorrow at the start of the Sunrise Safari to, fingers crossed, find Shadow and her lovely little cub. But you'll have to wait a few hours until the Sunrise Safari for that to become a reality. So for now, a big thank you to Gert, also known as Carrot, despite his objection to the nickname, for all of his fantastic camera work, as well as to the lovely Jerry and Rebecca in final control. Most importantly, thank you to all of you for joining us. I hope you had a marvelous sunset safari experience, and we'll catch up with you in a few short hours. For now, I'm going to say farewell and send you back over to Brent, who would also like to say his goodbyes. Cheers, everybody.
Well, hopefully we can conjure a nocturnal critter before the end of the sunset safari. And we are in a good area for that. We're on the southwestern bank of the Mawati River system. And there's some nice open clearings and sodic sites, thickets, so lots of different potential habitats. But really great to catch up with Mr. Q on the sunset safari. He definitely is starting to behave like a dominant leopard, and that's very young, very interesting. He is big for a four-year-old, but still quite interesting behavior. So it's going to be a very interesting little story that's going to play out there between him and Shivambalan. And of course, you never know when a new male might come in from the Kruger or from the south. So interesting times taking place around the Cheetah Plains area with the male leopards. And of course, hopefully Shadow and her little Bubba will be around on the Sunrise Safari. We're quite certain they've got a kill in there somewhere. Now it's just a matter of finding it. It is a massive area without any roads. And of course, it's always been a pleasure having Jandre on camera with me today. He behaved himself. He didn't sing once. I probably just jinxed it. I'm trying to see if he's about to burst into song. No, fortunately not. I shall survive. But thanks for joining us, and we'll see you in a few short hours for the Sunrise Safari.